I never have an idea what I'm going to say, or what's going to come out here. So welcome to the video. It's an adventure. You're not knowing where we're going to go to. We just start driving. There are three basic dates that the people are talking about, and one of them is March 23rd, which is coming up. What's today? Is today the 20th? Okay, so that would be Wednesday. This Wednesday, March 23rd. The other is June 6th, I believe, June 6th, and the other date that I'm saying is July 24th. So this is all in the ballpark. It's amazing that those who are able to look into the intentions of the mind are all coming up in this basic framework here of the spring and early summer in 2016. Major heads up for what's going forward. I would say you cannot, well, something is going to happen which is going to catch everyone by surprise, and it's going to be very devastating. And what we want to be is tip-top shape and out of emotional psychology, the psychology of emotion. We want to be out of that. This includes the rationalization that's part of the psychology of emotion, is the rationalization called intellect. The rationalization of absurdity, we call that mind, reason, intellect. It's not. It's not genuine reason at all. It's fake. It's like the reason of the French Revolution, they deified reason, but that wasn't reason. That was scientific, intellectual logic is what they tried to deify. That's not the reason that comes from the Holy Spirit at all. Which is really clarity. It's really clarity. Spiritual clarity. We want to be free of this emotional absurdity coming up. So this is what we're focusing on. Continually practicing. Now, if you're asking questions, you're not practicing. That's what I say. So if you start asking why this, just say wow and start practicing. Okay, wow, oh yeah, I need to practice. Instead of why, say wow. Okay, so how do we get out of this emotional psychology, the psychology of all this emotion, which is going to be exploited? It's horrible. And then people say, come down here, give us a hand. I say, no, I'm giving you a hand up. Come up here. I'm not going down there. You not down into that trap. You come up here out of the trap, or else be labeled as someone trying to entrap. Absolutely. The so-called good people of the world are here to entrap. We don't realize this. The good and bad absurdity are both absurd, equally absurd. And they say, well, I'm so good. I'm here. Come on down here and help me. No, you come on up here and help yourself. Help yourself to up here. You need to help yourself. In other words, it's like the ice cream is there. Help yourself to the ice cream. It's right there. If you're not willing to help yourself the ice cream, then that's something you have to work on. I'm not going to buy into absurdity. That doesn't help anyone. It's false help. Again, I keep trying to hammer this home. The world here, they believe that absurdity is salvation. And worshiping the God of absurdity is what we have to do. And we have to help out. They believe that God made this world and made humans and put them here and fixated them here. And it says you have to take care of all these things like gardeners. This is absurd. This is absurdity. So most people worship here in the world, they worship the God of absurdity, actually, which isn't a God at all. It's just absurdity claiming to be a god so that we will worship it. And of course, absurdity is just our own folly in trying to be greater than God, trying to fixate something other than God. God is the one fixation there is. So when absurdity says, we're going to fall into abyss if we let go of all fixations. No, we won't. We will simply find ourselves abiding in the perfect, one perfect fixation of God, God being God, pure abidance. We have four great teachers helping us out with this great effort to get to safe ground here, getting to safe ground, be grounded in sanity. So, Jesus, you might say the quality is Jesus. What is Jesus? Pure freedom. I think Jesus really, what he has expounded so well is pure freedom. Longchenpa, what has he expounded so well? Pure inherent spaciousness, inherent spaciousness. That's why the name Longchenpa, the great spaciousness, the one who has complete, perfectly, you know, complete great spaciousness, vast, great spaciousness. So Longchenpa is so good at the spaciousness. Ramana Maharshi, what is he so good at? Stillness, the peace, peace and stillness. And Ananda Maima, what is she so great at? Perfect action. Perfect action. That's what she did. She was constantly active, flawlessly, flawlessly active. You know, all actions were completely flawless. So she's like the paragon of enlightened action. Ramana Maharshi, paragon of peaceful stillness, abidance, and peaceful stillness. Longchenpa, the great adept of inherent spaciousness. And Jesus, the great advocate of freedom, which is our true identity. He says love, we say that he was a great apostle of love, but what he says is love is actually pure freedom. That is love. And loving is being aware that everything is free. We're all free. We're all free. Don't fixate anyone. Don't fixate anyone. He's the great master, the great exemplar, the great advocate of pure freedom as our identity. And so these are the qualities. These are some of the qualities of God, the one fixation that there is. So we will find ourselves perfectly fixated in God when we let go of our false fixations. False definitions. Trying to define what pure freedom. Sure, pure freedom is fixated as pure freedom. That's God. But that's the only fixation there is. There isn't any other. So we can literally let go of all other fixations and find ourselves perfectly fixated. There's no void at all. There's no abyss at all. There's no emptiness in terms of that at all. So all these fears that we have are completely unfounded. We will find ourselves perfectly, immaculately fixated in our perfect freedom, our perfect stillness, our perfect peace, our perfect inherent spaciousness, and our perfect experiencing action. Action experiencing. And all of those have a commonality of awareness, of course, of all of this perfect awareness. Aware of our freedom, aware of our action, aware of our inherent spaciousness, aware of our perfect stillness, perfect peace, perfect calm, all of that. Now, this is, you know, I'm there's no way I can overemphasize the troubles that are coming here, and how hard we're going to be hit, and how unexpectedly it hits. I've always told it has something to do with rock, with rocks. We're going to be rocked, very badly rocked. Extremely rocked. And this was symbolized by all these rocks coming down, and we're just in this confusion, and we're surrounded by rocks, and we can't move, we can't seem to move. We're just, everywhere you go, you run into this rock. Everywhere you go, you run into a rock. You run into a rock here, you run into a rock here, you run into here, and just your freedom seems to be gone. your inherent spaciousness seems to be, you know, blocked. Your stillness, perfect stillness, seems to be all, it's all agitated, and your perfect action seems to be blocked in every way. By every time you try to move, a rock is blocking you. Every time you move, this is what I saw in the dream: a rock is blocking you. A barrage of rocks. Barrage of rocks is what I saw in the dream. There's this massive barrage of rocks that just prevent you from functioning spiritually. You just feel so trapped. It is horrible. Now, last night I started really digging into, I came across this book called Lore of the World by what, Monsignor Benson, I think, back in 1905 he wrote it. It was published in what, 1907, I think. It's an extraordinary book. The Catholic Church takes it as prophetic, which is funny. The ex-Pope Francis Broglio advises everyone to read it. It's very important. Well, it's funny because he's one of the key people that's pointed out in the book as joining forces with, what's his name? Feldenberg, I think. Yeah, Feldenberg. Which, actually, look it up, it means house of place, a community of cliff, or precipice, cliff, and what is it? Is it rock also? Yeah, rock. Rocks are cliff. Feldenberg. In German, Felden. Yeah. So this book was written way back then, and it's really the most prophetic book of these times. It's astonishing. It is absolutely astonishing how accurate it is. Now, maybe not in every last regard, okay, because it's 396 pages. But you talk about someone nailing the future. Lord of the World. I got goosebumps in looking at it. I said, oh my gosh, this is just, it's turning out. He says there's this unknown senator from the Midwest who gains power in the United States, and then eventually gains more and more and more power. And ultimately, he somehow wins the presidency of Europe, becomes in charge of Europe too. And then this Catholic, powerful Catholic operative named Francis will join forces with him, and they'll set up this new world order, a secular humanism, and their real goal is to destroy religion, especially Christianity. Christianity, and it goes on and on and on and on. You say, wait a minute, it's like, is this somebody who's just writing about right now? No, this is 1905. That's over 111 years ago. Wow, this is pretty interesting, because I saw this barrage of rocks come crashing down on us on Highway 111. So 111 years ago, which we're at right now, 216, someone wrote about this. This is what's going to happen. There will be a crisis, terrible crisis come about, and then the people will, all around the world, will accept this Feldenberg as the world leader, and eventually he'll declare himself God of this world. And this Francis will support him in that. This Catholic named Francis. Yeah, gee, I wonder who that might be. And I wonder who this unknown person coming out of nowhere, who becomes a senator out of the Midwest, who gains the presidency of the United States. I wonder who that might be. And they talk about, you know, his charismatic ability to give speeches and move people emotionally and all this stuff. Gee, I just wonder who that might be. So this Lord of the World, this, I believe it's Benson. I could be wrong. I'm new to the name. But you can look it up. Lord of the World book. It's a mind blower. I don't know what to say. You talk about something that's so extraordinary like this. So anyway, it's exactly what everybody is saying now, right? About the New World Order and the trouble that's coming. It is not a joke. Now, what I have seen in my dreams over and over and over, and externally as a barrage of rocks, we get hit with a barrage of rocks, and we lose our freedom. We're not able to function. We're just devastated. And I always say, well, I'm not sure if it's like an asteroid that's going to come in, or is that referring to some political, social situation, psychological situation? You know, exactly, is this symbolic? Is a literal barrage of rocks from like space hitting us? Or is it something else? Now, in the dream, it seemed there was just this massive barrage of rocks that just ended up rolling all over, the roll out everywhere. And so then there were just these boulders and rocks just in everyone's way. We're still living in our houses. It was very dusty and dusty, big dust up, but maybe that's confusion. But we just couldn't function. We couldn't function. I managed to escape it. I went to Freeway 10 to Arizona, a reduced intensity zone. Didn't get caught in it. Did not get caught in this. I outraced it. I was doing like 100, over 100 miles an hour, going really fast, which is what I'm doing right now. And I tell everyone, boycott. All the stuff I said to boycott, it's on my website, alohawellness.wix.com/fullstopinthewow. There's a list on the left. It's just some things to boycott. I'm having a hard time, but I'm trying to keep going. It's starting to try and creep up on me. I've got to reaffirm. You know, it's tough. I feel the world is really pressuring us. The yoga girls, the glamour, everything is just ferocious. Just ferocious. It's actually trying to creep back into me. It's scary. It's very scary. We would be well served to retreat somewhere. So far it hasn't happened. But so just try to boycott this stuff. I say boycott it through July 24th. Boycott it through July 24th. That's not too much to ask. Today's the 20th of March. So April, May, June, July. Just 4 months of boycott. Just 4 months of boycott. That's a quarter mile. That's a third of a year. I say burn up that quarter mile. Song from Jan and Dean, Drag City. Burn up that quarter mile. That last quarter mile, you know, just goes... Do as much, as fast as you can, as good as you can, and just be really dedicated. Then you reach the finish line, you know, congratulations. And then we'll see from that point, we'll see. But this will keep you from fertilizing these complexes, emotional complexes. The fertilization is ferocious at the emotional level now, at all of this absurdist level, really, which is emotional level, is absurdism. That's not true feeling at all. It is simply off the charts. It's horrible. That's why I say don't even dabble in it. Boycott it. Truly boycott it. When you boycott something, it means zero. Have a zero tolerance. It's funny, you hear about this zero tolerance policy for this. Well, let's have a zero tolerance policy for the world the next 4 months, right? The emotionalistic, absurdist world. The glamorized world. All of this. Zero tolerance for it. Now I say, let me say, well, what do I do? Yeah, well, that is a tough one. I tape. You can listen to the tapings. I read a little bit on the, if I can find some good spiritual information on the internet. Study, read, think about, do beautiful graphics, and think about, consider, practice. I practice a lot, and then work out, stretch, limber, work out. I got these rubber bands. You know those colorful rubber bands now with handles. You can hook them on the handles and you stretch. I got one of those and I'm starting to stretch, trying to, you know, strengthen the upper body. Just, you know, you keep yourself going in a simple way right now. Now, you get this Lord of the World and you get this confirmation of this Feldenberg character. And how he's going to declare himself Lord of the World. And you see how everything is working in that direction. And then you get the prophetic perspective that I have. as far as saying there's going to be some trouble with rocks, severe barrage of rocks that is just going to bury us in a mental fixation, you might say. We'll become very fixated. This is what I saw in the dream. People couldn't move. They were fixated. Severely fixed. A severe fixation is coming upon the world. The worst ever. Immeasurable fixation. You just simply don't sit around like a scientist saying, well, I need to be here to measure it. You know, be a spiritual scientist and saying, okay, if it goes over this level, this is like flood tide. If it goes over the flood tide, then that's a flood, and we want to avoid the flood. So, you know, have better parameters than just, you know, a geek-like, you know, measurement. Say, well, I am measuring it. You know, is it, you know, below flood stage or is it above flood stage? That's a good measurement, right? And if it's above flood stage, then get to higher ground. You know, what is not scientific about that? To someone who doesn't get to higher ground, are they smarter? They say, well, no, they're stupid. They're stupider. Or stupider. They're rationalizing their failure to practice by saying, oh, no, I'm doing something important here. No, you failed is what you do, and you're rationalizing your failure. See, people who say that, there are many ways to rationalize failure. To remain within absurdity out of fear of the abyss and out of failure to look at the situation. Rationalize in all sorts of ways that we're very good at rationalizing. Now, I was trying to figure out last night, I didn't try to force it. This is something that I'm good at. I make great efforts. I don't try to force things. I say, it will come. If it's meant to come, it will come. I just put it in the hands of the Holy Spirit. I say, Holy Spirit, you bring it to my attention if it's right. I couldn't quite put it all together, but just now when I'm making this taping, the right terminology came, barrage of racks, of rocks. Is the trouble we are facing. Let this settle in. Let this settle in. The key element also in all this is that some Catholic, a powerful Catholic named Francis, will back up this Feldenberg character and say he is the Lord of the world. And that's the key element. So you have the Catholic Church backing up some super powerful, suave politician who's gained enormous worldwide acclaim and seems to be the natural leader to help this world solve all sorts of crises. And he will declare himself Lord of the world, and Francis will back him up on that. So this is a powerful, powerful issue here. So, barrage of rocks. Rock, barrack, barrage of rocks, barrage, barrocks. Wonder whose name is barrack. You know anybody who has the name of barrack, standing short for barrage of rocks? Pronounced rock, could be spelled R-A-C-K, rock. It's pronounced rock, rock. Barrage of rocks, barrack. Anyone, you know anyone by that name that might fit the description of Feldenberg, who's aim, ambition is to be Lord of the world? But I don't know. If you know anybody by that first name, you might want to pay attention. And Francis, anyone named Francis who has this powerful position in the Catholic Church, who seems to be a secular humanist at heart and might go along with this? Yeah, I don't know. Just pull the names out of a hat here. Yeah, maybe something will come to mind. Wow, this is very powerful. It fits the dreams that I've been having. There's also in Christian tradition what they say is first the first will arise, and this is said to be, they believe this will happen on June 6th, is the man of lawlessness will make his presence feel, the Antichrist, is called the man of lawlessness, someone who disregards the laws and makes his own laws. Does that bring anyone to mind? Someone who feels like, let me just, you don't want to go along, well, I'll just sign an executive order here, and that's the law now. Is that, I don't know, if it brings anyone to mind. Man of lawlessness. Who simply establishes his own laws for what he wants. Someone who encourages riots, maybe, blaming the law, blaming the police for all the problems, encouraging lawlessness. Does anyone come to mind there? Someone who says, oh yeah, criminals, the thugs, the cities, they're innocent. It's the police that are the lawless ones. It's the police that are the lawless ones. Of course, what if they find one bad apple or a couple bad apples in among, you know, hundreds of thousands, and they use that to smear all the hundreds of thousands. And they say, oh no, the criminals, the crooks, the thugs that are going on rampages, shooting and looting and doing all that. No, they're innocent, pure as driven snow. It's all the police's fault. Wouldn't that be a good definition of a man of lawlessness? Possible, huh? Now, I know the people from the 60s, the 70s, I being a child of the 60s, my teens started in 1969, 13, and that just bridged 69 and 70. So my teens are mostly spent from 69 through 75. So it's that era, which is a very impressionable era. I understand that back then, the Vietnam War protests, I think the Vietnam War ended in what, 1974, 5? Yeah, that the police were the enemy, okay, because they were part of the corporate war and military industrial complex, okay. We understand that. And a lot of people were using drugs at that time. They're afraid of getting busted, put away in jail. I mean, so, and there was a youth rebellion, all this stuff. Okay, that's all understandable. But now, in hindsight, what, 40 years later, 40 years later, you know, there's a different perspective of it all. It's a little wiser perspective. And I cannot fathom why people who've gained wisdom and perspective are still thinking that the police are the enemy. You know, that's a juvenile attitude, actually. Police have never been anything but kind and helpful to me, okay, in my life. All my interactions with police have been very, very good. And not, you know, no bad interactions. They've always been simply helpful, courteous, kind. And when you look in experiencing the criminal element of what's going on, in listening to them, you realize what an incredibly difficult job and what a terrible, stressful tightrope they have to walk. It's like they're put in an impossible situation. Because the laws favor criminals now more than ever. And the people that I talk with, they don't like to admit it, but they think they can trust me. They say, hey, you know what, you know, I think, you know, the police are getting a raw deal. They really are. And I say, I agree, absolutely agree. You know, if someone's trying to break into your home, attack you, who do you call? The police? Who are the people that show up and protect you? The police, of course. who's, I mean, they pulled all the police out of Almaden Valley here, which is a very prosperous, wealthy area, because of cutbacks. and you know, lack of support for the police. They couldn't man the area anymore. What happened? The gang members came in from the east side and up the peninsula, Oakland side, Oakland and that area, the East Bay, East San Jose, that whole area. They knew that the no police there, and they just literally began invading homes just at any time they wanted to. Broad daylight, people in the house didn't matter. They just tied them up. And it was just massive invasion of break-ins and robberies, just constantly. It was every day. There was a number of break-ins. It's nobody's safe. It doesn't matter how wealthy you are. And no police to respond to them at all. And it became a terror zone, actually. Terrifying. The people who were living this wonderful, beautiful suburban life there were now terrified. Terrified, living in terror. And they had to hire their own private security teams to try and, you know, prevent this. It's horrible if you don't have policing. Absolutely horrible what will happen. And yet, who is it that's targeting the police and framing them, framing them to be the bad guys? Who is it that's trying to ennoble the criminals? Like, ah, they're really actually real good people. Yeah, sure, they tried to shoot the policemen. Sure, they were robbing stores, but they're really good people. You know, it wasn't their fault, and just society doesn't understand them and stuff. Who is in trying to ennoble the criminals and demonize the law, law enforcement? Who is it that's actually doing that in this country, in a prominent position? Is that, if someone did that, wouldn't you say he's a man of lawlessness? Kind of the definition of lawlessness. You embolden the criminals and say, I got your back. And you demonize the police and say, look, if you try to do anything, I'm going to smash you. That kind of sounds like the perfect definition of lawlessness, doesn't it? So somebody that's the chief of that ideology would be called the man of lawlessness. Bringing down a barrage of rocks upon us. Collapse of law and order. Rocks everywhere, you know, obstructions everywhere, loss of freedom, martial law perhaps, you know, all these various things. A barrage of rocks. Wherever you go, you run into this. A rock here, a rock here, a rock here. There's rocks, you know, just everywhere. It's a rocky road. Everything is suddenly a rocky road. You can't. There's no smooth travel. That's what I saw. You can't travel smoothly. You can't go places smoothly. Everything is restricted, 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 restricted. So many restrictions suddenly are going to be piled upon us here. Suddenly. Horribly. So would anyone put it that past the man of lawlessness to make his move, you know, make his move at some point. Secretly having the backing of someone named Francis. Catholic, powerful Catholic. Maybe the, you know, hey, if the shoe fits, if the shoe fits. Secretly having the agreement of the European leaders to not oppose this. Okay? How do we know there haven't been secret agreements already made to strip America of its guns, for instance, so it cannot protect itself against lawlessness? How do we know there haven't already been secret agreements made with the European leaders and with the Vatican that they will not intervene and they think this is a good thing? How do we know the man of lawlessness said, look, this is what I plan to do, and will you go along with this? We'll get rid of all guns in this country. We'll make it a peaceful country. We'll structure it the way you want it. It'll be really a new world order. Everything will be great. Finally, we'll break the back of the Christians, and you know, dearm, get all their arms so they can't defend their liberty and freedom. How do we know that the Europeans and the Vatican won't say, "Hey, that's exactly what we want. Go for it." We won't raise a finger. In fact, we'll applaud it. And did you know that the only place in this world, really, that has an unfavorable opinion of this particular president with the first name of Barack, is the United States. The rest of the world thinks he's God on earth. because they don't know what's going on, actually. They think, yeah, America, they're terrible. Anybody who can strip the power from America and blend them, meld, pasteurize, meld them into the world. Oh, that's going to be a great world. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Europe's really doing great, aren't they? Yeah, the world's really doing wonderful. Now, we have what's called freedom of expression here, which means we're supposed to criticize our leaders, and they're only temporary at best. Because what we found throughout history, the lessons of history, this country is founded by those who were geniuses about the lessons of history. They say political, bureaucratic power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And it's all about limiting the power of the executive here, okay? That's why local representation, it's United States, states that are united through their representatives, okay? So we have a balance of powers, but designed to limit the power of the executive branch above all else. And we have an arbiter of the Supreme Court, which can be stacked, unfortunately, in various ways. It's not a perfect system by any means. But we have a constitution that's supposed to be adhered to limit the power of the executive, to avoid tyranny. So the founders that wrote the Constitution were students of history. They were very bright, and they understood that there are terrible problems when you concentrate too much power in the executive branch, in the ruler. It has to be diffused. The power should be diffused among the people, with local representation, state representation, all of that being ones that it may not please everybody, you know, or may not please any of us all the time, and so but it's way better than concentrating too much power in the executive. That's when severe trouble arises. So you're supposed to elect presidents that respect that balance of powers and understand that and don't try to overstep it. And if they do try to overstep it, then they're removed from office. And they limit the terms to 8 years of any particular demagogue, you know, president. That's it. So you can't do too much damage if you're really bad and you've rigged things in a certain way. You can't do too much damage. And what they're afraid of is some real powerful demagogue gaining power. Because after 8 years, they're gone. And it's unlikely that they'll be succeeded by someone who's just as powerful demagogically. They understand that throughout history, there have been certain hypnotic leaders, like a Napoleon, a Hitler, various things. Well, they didn't come along by the time of the Constitution, but I'm using more recent examples. But there have been various examples throughout history of this type, this magnetic, hypnotic, demagogic type of leader who's able to get people backing them so strongly and then lead them in a disaster. But usually it's a one-off sort of situation. Okay, and then so if you replace them in 8 years with someone else, things are going to go back to normal, pretty much. This is how it goes. So they said no matter how good you are, 8 years, no matter how bad you are, 8 years is the max, is the max. This is a protection. This is a very, very great protection. So some people would have loved to see Ronald Reagan have a third term, but no, you're not allowed to do that under any circumstances. So this is the price we pay. Even the good leaders that some say are good, even those we have to say goodbye to. And we understand this is the price we pay for avoiding the worst trap of all, which is the powerful, suave, hypnotic orator demagogue who feels that they have a mission in this world to rule all and know what's best for everybody. You avoid that situation. This is all important. Because that's when the yoke of tyranny comes about. Now, Americans know this. The United States are perhaps the most sophisticated when it comes to this form, because they're the ones with the longest democracy, right, in the world. So we don't have to play second fiddle to all these other countries in the world who are pretending to tell us how to govern ourselves. People say, "Well, you're a young country, blah blah blah." And yeah, we may be young in terms of years, but we have the longest running democracy in the world. So we're the experts on it, actually. So far be it from these other countries to lecture us about it. Hey, really? We're the ones who have exported democracy and tried to train other countries in democracy and how to set up constitutions and so that they avoid tyranny. We're the ones who have done that. So in no way are we some ignorant, foolish people that should be lectured and the world should tell us what to do. I mean, we don't accept that in the slightest bit, and there's no grounds for that to stand upon whatsoever. Now we listen to what people say because we understand we have an open mind, etc. But we're not going to be put in this one down position, this gamesmanship the world's engaging in at all. Most countries still very up to very recently had tyranny in their country. They don't understand freedom. They don't understand representative democracy the way we do. We've been living it since, 1776. Years. And ironing out the rough spots, and we understand the ups and downs. It's ragged. We live with the raggedness of it. That's the price you pay. So we understand there's a price to pay. But you have to have good citizens to make it work. And you have to have people that want to work to make it work. And it gets undermined. It's being undermined now. You have to respect law and order because it is a bit ragged. So if you get a man of lawlessness in there, doesn't respect law and order, and champions the criminal and chaos, that's subverting the country. It's subverting the Constitution. It's subverting democracy. Extremely subversive to democracy. Because there are disagreements in democracy, but everybody here needs to understand that sometimes things will go your way, sometimes they won't go your way. There's a price to pay for democracy. And we've done a great job in that here. And it's not easy at all. It's not easy. But what it's enabled us is given us some freedom to think, fresh air to think, to consider ideas. Without feeling that we're going to be jailed for those ideas or persecuted for those ideas. And one of the outcomes of that is all the inventions come out of America, all the ideas that have come out of this system. But more important than that, religious, spiritual ideas. There's been a lot of consideration here about spirituality and all of that, and there's been a lot of good, tremendous amount of spirituality come out of the United States and in different ways, actually, which is being extremely subverted right now. You had Christian Science, for instance. You had the New Mind, a new thought movement. Had A Course in Miracles come out of the United States of America. These are powerful, powerful teachings. Tremendous teachings. You've had a massive amount of missionary work come out of America from Christians. Trying to preach love, tolerance, forgiveness, and get them interested in Jesus. Even though it starts out rudimentary, it's still, a very positive path, very positive path. So religious freedom is super important in this country, super important, which is why you have the right to bear arms is to protect your liberties from executive tyranny from the executive. And that has been, there's been a massive attempt to undermine this from what you call communists and socialists and New World Order people, to demonize the United States, to demonize these people who love liberty. Massive effort to subvert this. So don't be surprised at all if the subversion comes crashing down on our heads here. This soon, within the next 4 month period, actually. All in the name of some wonderful new world order, some brave new world, some wonderful thing. What we realize here in the United States is there is no such thing. That you can never have a perfect form of governance or a perfect form of society. You can never have a utopia here. This is the price we pay. This is the greatness of Christianity and other religions, which we have religious tolerance here, is realize that this world is not really our home. Okay, Jesus was very emphatic about this. He said, don't try to perfect this world. Don't lay your treasure up, in other words, in this world where everything is subject to corruption and decay and death. He says, lay your treasure, your heart, your efforts, your attention on the world, the translation's not quite right, the world that is to come, I mean the world that is awaiting for you, the higher world, you know, the kingdom of heaven. Put your attention on the kingdom of heaven, not this world. He said, when he left the world, they said, why are you leaving? He said, this is not my world. This is the kingdom of darkness, the devil's world, you know, the adversary's world, absurdity's world. It's not my realm at all. What are you talking about? This is a terrible place. He said, I didn't come to save the world, I came to condemn it. This is a very important saying of Jesus Christ. I didn't come to save this world, I came to condemn it. So we have an understanding here that this world is terrible. I mean, don't try to make a utopia out of this world. This is when disaster strikes. This is the trap of the adversary, the trap of absurdity, is wooing us, seducing us into this belief we can have this perfect world here. What happens is we become yoked to tyranny and slavery when that's really the slaveholders are preaching this stuff to the ones they want to enslave. The New World Order is really an enslavement agenda. And the ones who want to own all the slaves, they're preaching this utopia and using these operatives, these demagogues, to bring it about for them so they can enslave us, have all these slaves teaching us, trying to teach a false religion, false religious viewpoint, which says, no, you're supposed to perfect this world. This is your home. This is your utopia. You're not really free. That's false spirituality is what they're promoting. Our four great teachers here, all of them have been emphatic about this world is not our home. Of course, Jesus, absolutely emphatic about it, as we have just said. Longchenpa said the happiest day in his life was when he left this world, when he gathered the students about him and said, okay, I'm ready to leave this world. And he says, don't despair, don't stop your practice. In fact, do even more now. He's been saying, because this is the greatest day of my life, greater than any enlightenment, greater than anything that's happened to me, is finally I'm leaving this place and I'm going to dwell in the death-free realm. That's what he told them directly. He said, it's just the great, I'm just so happy to get to leave this place. That's the attitude we should have too. It's like, wow. Isn't that great? As long as we don't get a ticket back here, you know, that's the thing that bothers me. So very emphatic about this. Ram Maharshi said this world is nothing, nothing whatsoever. Put no stock in this world, what our bodies, human beings, human race, human, any of this whatsoever. Place no stock in it. It's like a nightmare dream. He placed no stock in it whatsoever. Ananda Maima said, no matter what you think right now, it's inevitable, it is a fact that all of you must go to dwell in the death-free realm eventually. You cannot stay here. You cannot stay here. This is not your home. You must dwell in the death-free realm. So all of them have the same emphasis on this. Now, unfortunately, the contamination is going on, ongoing now. Christianity is getting into this prosperity consciousness preachers now who teaching, you know, God wanted you to have everything here in this world and be happy here in this world and prosper here in this world. He put you here to be custodians of this world and prosper. This is all nonsense. Jesus never said anything of the sort, actually. They twisted and distorted everything. So the right form of governance is a ragged one that prevents accumulation of power anywhere, too much accumulation of power anywhere. Prevents this utopian ideal from grabbing hold of our psyches. Utopian ideal in this world, because what it really turns into is a dystopia. And this book, Lore of the World, is really this ultimate dystopian prophecy, how the world is going to get sold on this utopian idea of secular humanism, and it's going to turn into this terrible dystopia. And it's a very intellectual book, and it's I haven't read the book, but I've read excerpts of it and synopsis, and it's just like it's right on the money in so many ways. This is what is coming to this world. Now, I just saw this temperature graph of this summer, the predicting long-term predictions. They say most of the United States is going to be either much hotter than normal or hotter than normal. Only a small area in Texas is going to be cooler than normal. Good for the Texans. It'll help them keep their cool. They're going to need to keep their cool. That's for sure. The rest of the country, you don't want a long, hot summer this year. You can already feel, I can feel what's coming. What the New World Order, the number one agenda is to take the guns away from the Americans. That is all important to them, because that's what stands in the way of their tyranny. Of course, they claim that's what stands in the way of utopia. They have this utopian blueprint to make this planet just an unbelievably great place, completely ignoring the fact that the other side of the coin of absurdity, which this planet is a reflection of absurdity, actually, bodies, planet, this is a projection, mental projection, of trying to be greater than God and believing in definition, that what God is, which is perfect freedom, can be defined, which is completely absurd. This is absurdity. And the flip side, the other side of the coin, which, of course, you can't have a coin with one side, so the two are inseparable, is paranoia, fear of non-definition, being an abyss. Because in denying God, which is the one perfect fixation, we feel there's no fixation at all if we don't define ourselves. We're supposed to define ourselves as this body, as this thing, as a world. Materialism, that secular materialism, is born out of paranoia. The foundation of secular humanist materialism is paranoia, and the other side of that is absurdity. It's one coin of absurdity and paranoia. How can you have a perfect utopia which is founded on paranoia, and everybody has paranoia in their personalities, which is unmistakably will be so? How is it possible that the only remedy that they say is put all your power in some external force, dictatorship, which can control you with severe penalties, and try to put this draconian sort of exoteric external control system, a bureaucratic control system, which of course has been tried in China and Soviet Union, is a disaster, right? All over the world has been tried throughout history, is despotism. To try to get rid of this paranoia. It never works. It never works, and it never will work. It never will work at all. So what we're doing is we're just going into another cycle of delay. Of course, another definition of rock, R-A-C-K, rock, about rock, R-A-C-K, to rack someone is to put them under severe pressure, torture them, put them under excruciating pressure. the rack was used to torture people. To rack someone is to put them under horrible pressure. Horrible pressure. Torturous pressure. A barrage of racking. A barrage of racking. A barrage of rocks. This is this bureaucratic control, tyranny, this massive octopus, spider's web, to try and have a utopia. In other words, keep the absurdity, but get rid of the paranoia, get rid of the fear. This is what they think they can accomplish, and all great teachers throughout history have said this is absolutely impossible, and this is what we've come here to tell you. This is what you need to hear. It's absolutely impossible to do this. None of these great teachers came to design some sort of utopian governmental system here, actually. In fact, they ignored it. Jesus ignored it, did he not? They tried to make him Messiah in the lineage of King David. He said, no. That's not salvation. Longchenpa wouldn't have anything to do with any of that. He said, avoid that like the plague. Rama Maharshi, of course, had nothing to do with that. And Anumayama, of course, had absolutely nothing to do with that. They wanted to make her the mother goddess of the world to rally this utopia around, or this New World Order. She was supposed to be the figurehead of the New World Order, and she said, absolutely not. That's ridiculous. This is a misunderstanding of spiritual truth and teaching. And it tried to make her, you know, pull her into politics. She refused, absolutely refused. Said, this is totally, totally off track. She says, what are you talking about? Everything's already perfect. Why are you trying to prove the world is already immaculately perfect? She said, God's governance is already perfectly in control of the world. That's what she said. God's governance is absolute and already perfectly in control of everything. Nothing ever strays from God's governance. God, the fixation of truth, God's truth. From ultimate freedom, nothing, she said, ever strays in the slightest bit from that. So, what are you talking about fixing something? She said, you need to fix your belief system, is what you need to do. Not so. Look out for these figureheads. In the book, Lord of the World, it was said that this Feldenberg character, I believe I'm saying that right. He put himself in this temple, and there's this huge statue of the Mother Goddess there. And that this is where he proclaimed himself Lord of the World. This is where Francis also blessed him as Lord of the World. Under the aegis of this Mother Goddess. That's plays a big role in his book, this Mother God, worship of the Mother Goddess. And of course, this Francis, the Broglio guy, is essentially a huge worshiper of the Mother Goddess. Calls her the Virgin Mary, which is a really misappropriation of the Virgin Mary, who was likely a saint, but not a Mother Goddess at all. She would be abhorrent at anyone suggesting such a thing. If she followed the teachings of Jesus, she would abhor such a notion. She'd say, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This world here is just an absurdist projection. You want me to be the mother goddess of an absurdist projection? No, thank you. So, we are headed in that direction faster than we realize. This is what the Holy Spirit is pointing out to me. And Jesus said it will come upon us like a thief in the night. Now, the trouble is already, the Holy Spirit, July 24th, Holy Spirit said is when you're going, psychologically, there's going to be some sort of psychological shift. Whatever causes it, there will be some shift. He said, very bad. Now we know, it was pointed out to me, that Trump said there's going to be riots if if they, you know, deny him the nomination. Okay, and what is the, what is their, when is their convention? Was it the 18th through the 21st, I believe, of July? So if he's denied the nomination, 22, 23, 24, riots may start on the 22nd, 23rd, and on the 24th there may be some, you know, declaration by Feldenberg or the barrage of rocks, or, you know, something may happen, or it just may be this split in the country that leads to martial law or something, you know, something along those lines. I don't know exactly, but you could feel the buildup there. And it's, now, take it from someone who has a little perspective here, having lived through the Cold War, okay, the aftermath of the Korean War, the Cold War, lived through the Vietnam War, okay, and all the troubles with that, and then all the subsequent situations, the unrest, the tension, of all of that stuff, have experienced all that and made a lot of mistakes along the way through all of that, I could tell you what is coming seems to be much heavier than that, way heavier than that. And that's why I say, uh-oh. Every time I think I get lazy, I say, wait a minute. I mean, something heavier than the Vietnam, the civil unrest in America, during the Vietnam War, which is my whole teens was the Vietnam War, where I was afraid of being drafted. It was like terrifying. I mean, the unrest was just astronomical here. And the civil rights movement also lived through a whole civil rights movement. The feminist, feminism arose just when I started being a teenager. And so my whole teens were dominated by Vietnam conflict, by feminism, all this stuff. Having lived through all of this severe activism, severe heaviness, severe turmoil, this is some, you know, gives me a great perspective on how to prepare for what I see is a coming severe civil unrest in this country and the world, and stuff, draconian measures being taken likely. And like I say, no sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. That is for sure. Do not turn in that direction. Do not turn to the world. Do not turn for a political solution. Do not turn in those directions that don't work. There's a lot of stuff that makes it worse. It doesn't work. So you have to suffer a bit. You have to be willing to suffer a little bit. You have to keep centered in spiritual practice, actually, is the key. Is your ability to practice spiritually is the key to the entire situation. You cannot let that lapse. You have to have faith in that. And so, starting in 1978, I started intense spiritual practice, and I've never let up a single day since. Before, it was more haphazard. I was studying, thinking, trying to, how do I protect myself from all this turmoil? 1978, I started A Course in Miracles under the teaching of Jesus, the help of Jesus, and from that, I've been able to maintain, keep working on spiritual practice, so that every day is just sort of a continual focus on that. You keep coming back to it. You don't lose yourself. You don't lose your center. Your habits are so grounded in that, you don't lose it into these other things, drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll, which was it's a disaster. It's a disaster. And emotionalism, just emotionalism in general. You don't go in that direction of emotionalism, of bickering, of arguing, of activism, all this kind of stuff. It seems very heady, like to join a whole bunch of people that are all emotional, and you get swept up in this, and temporarily euphoric. But really, what happens is you lose your center, and your ability to practice the way we're practicing, which is detachment from this world. Don't lay your treasures up in this world at all. Put your faith in a reduced intensity zone that you have the right to go there, which we absolutely do. So put your faith in empowerment, spiritual, genuine spiritual empowerment, which comes from truth. Now, we're still waiting, still not waiting, but preparing for some more help in this direction. And I'm just put my faith that it will come. Where there's some really adamant center spiritual knowing that helps us maintain our practice. I would say this is very crucial. Very, very important. Someone who's so centered in spiritual truth that they influence others around them, that, hey, I can keep working to stay centered in this. I can keep going that direction. That's where it's at. This is a protection. This is supreme protection from devastating troubles, actually. What about this, the fake Jesus in Santa Monica and maybe around the world? Why would the New World Order do that? Well, I'll tell you why. Possibly, potentially. It would be to try and suck in as many Christians and believers as possible to believing in this fake Jesus. Now, this fake Jesus may go along and support, you know, the New World Order, or this is another possibility. At some point, when so many people of faith have bought into this and put all their faith in that, at some point it will be revealed that it's all a fake. It's all a fake, and then the New World Order will say, you see, you guys are a bunch of gullible idiots believing in religion and Jesus and all this stuff, and just shame them into silence and collapse their will at that point. This is another possibility, actually. Crush their spirits, saying all along it was just an actor, it was all fake. See how stupid you are? See how you need better governance? See how we can't trust you? We're justified in not trusting you, and we're justified in not giving you any power in our society, because look how you squandered, look how idiotic you were. This is another potential usage of this, faking the return of Jesus instead of the real return of Jesus. The real return of Jesus is one is so adamant about truth that it's able to keep those that are aligned with that, keep them practicing and keep them centered in their practice. That's the real Jesus. But not emotionalism. No, not emotionalism at all. The times that I've met Jesus, there's no emotionalism at all. Very calm and peaceful and quiet. He's not some military general type. So, one of those two outcomes. One, that Jesus would say that indeed that this that he blesses the Lord of this world and leads everyone into this mother goddess worshiping and New World Order utopian nonsense. And people go along with that, and it moves the obstructions. Or two, people are so the Christians are so diverted from that that they don't even see what's happening, the takeover. Or three, it's exposed as a fraud at some point, and then it just devastates their spirit, crushes them. Just kind of like that Harold Camping guy who said the end of the world is coming, all these billboards all over the country, and it's, he named the date, it's coming on this date, it's coming on this date. And then when the end of the world and the rapture didn't happen, it was a severe blow to a lot of Christians. Like, it smeared them all. Like, wow, you're a bunch of idiots. You know, look how gullible, stupid you are. You're just a bunch of, you got something wrong with your brain. You're suffering from a mental disease. That kind of stuff is very, very hurtful. Okay. So we're not setting dates in terms of end of the world or terms of rapture or anything like that. We're just giving a heads up to some potentialities here. For increased psychological pressure here in the world. Increased psychological pressure. Where what I mean is where our practice, our centeredness is in danger. We're in danger of losing our good habits. This is another way to put it. We're in danger of losing our good habits. And I can feel the pressure right now. Right now, I mean, this March, someone said March 23rd is a very important date. It's feeling like it. I mean, it feels like there is just, I had a, you know, if you could feel it, you know what I'm talking about. It feels like the jaws are, you know, shutting on us, right? The jaws of totalitarianism are shutting upon us, and it's been going on for a long time. And many have detailed it, actually, of all the different laws that have been changed and rearranged, and the undermining and sabotaging of religious freedom and freedom in general, and the shaming and demonizing of those who stand up for that. And it just goes on and on and on. The death of Nancy Reagan, well, I think everything has changed since then, actually. I've been feeling an enormous stress since then. It's as if somehow the totalitarians are emboldened now, because the last symbol of that era is gone, you know, the last powerful symbol of that era, which stood up for democracy, representative democracy, for stood up for individual freedoms, who supported, you know, all the basic agenda of how to protect freedom, et cetera, that generation, who really got it, who really understood. Not that it's all wonderful. No. It's ragged. You disagree with some things and agree with other things. I mean, what politician, leader, whatever, do you agree with everything they do? It's ridiculous. You may agree with some stuff and hate some other stuff they do. And say, ah, oh, that's terrible. That's democracy. You don't always get what you want, but sometimes you get what you need. Here, just might find you get what you need, which is the freedom to consider true freedom. I guess you could say it gives you some freedom to consider what real freedom is all about, actually, what true freedom is all about, which is drop your attempt to fixate what you are beyond what you really are, the fixation that you truly are, instead of trying to add other fixations upon that. Drop those other fixations. And you realize what you are is perfect freedom. You can't realize your perfect freedom if you're trying to fixate yourself. Even though you're failing to fixate yourself, you keep trying, so you're not really experiencing your perfect freedom. You're not really experiencing it the way it's meant to be experienced. There seems to be like a constriction, you know, there something doesn't feel right. Yeah, of course, we're trying to fixate ourselves so that we're trying to pretend that freedom and our freedom doesn't exist. That's right. So Nancy Reagan, since the death of Nancy Reagan, I didn't even know it happened, but I was feeling so stressed out, and then someone told me, oh, they mentioned it. I said, what? I didn't even know. It was like several days afterwards, because I don't follow the news. They said, oh, you didn't, oh, Nancy Reagan. I said, why are the flags at half mast? I said, oh, Nancy Reagan died. Or someone mentioned it to me. I didn't really think about it. But then I asked the Holy Spirit, what's the big deal? Why am I feeling so stressed? Is that why? Why am I? And the Holy Spirit said, that's why you're feeling so stressed, is the totalitarians now feel like their pathway is unopposed, you know. That she could have rallied, psychologically rallied people, psychologically. And because that there's a psychological connection to those times when Americans didn't have to apologize for themselves constantly, and weren't feeling so ashamed of themselves, and weren't feeling, and a lot of things, that it was okay to be an American. And we understood that we're not perfect, but it's still okay. And we had confidence and optimism, and we still had religious freedom. Christians were not demonized. We said no to drugs, no to immorality, no to criminals. Well, there's a great respect for law and order. All this stuff, when all that was still strong, there's a psychological connection to that. And when Nancy Reagan died, there's a very, you know, severe drop in that. It's like, wow, that regime is gone. There was a certain respect for the Constitution back then, and nobody was above the Constitution. And you know, if you wanted to do something and the Constitution said no, you had to bite your lip and say, that's the way the cookie crumbles. I can't do it. So there's a certain humility there that said, we're going to follow the laws of the land, And is, you know, it wasn't perfect. It wasn't perfect by any means. It never is. But there was this, you know, you bow to what? To people? No, you bow to the Constitution, the laws of the land, and you try your best not to subvert it. You understand that, that it's not about you. It's about the greater good of everyone. The country is not about some person. It's not about some politician, okay? No, they're just servants of the greatness of the country, the greatness of democracy here. It's not about them. So you certainly don't want to have a president who thinks it's about them. You know? That's trouble. That they're doing you a favor, you know, it's all about them. That the system isn't so great, the Constitution isn't so great, it's all terrible, it's all flawed, and they're here to say, you know, I'm better than all that. It's about me. You know, that's an egomaniac, actually, suffering from megalomania born of severe paranoia, born of a lack of spiritual grounding, grounding in spiritual practice. A lack of grounding in spiritual practice is what brings this about. In other words, when you go to the birthplace of Jesus, how do you act? Do you strut about like you're the boss there? Or do you be absorbed in prayer and thanks to Jesus, you know? How do you act? Well, I think we have the record. It's on the record pretty clearly how this present fellow acted there in the birth nativity church of the nativity of Jesus. No sign of humility whatsoever. Acted like he owned the place. That's not someone who's steeped in spiritual practice. So if you're not grounded in spiritual practice, call it whatever you want to, prayer, meditation, contemplation, assertions, full stop on the wow. If you're not steeped in spiritual practice of some sort, prayers, paranoia will rule your personality, and that can grow into a terrible affliction called megalomania. The feeling that you have to control everybody, and the feeling that you have the divine right to control everyone. It's called the divine right of kings. This is megalomania born of paranoia. So the reason why Christianity, democracy could take root in this country is so many Christians came here who are rooted in prayer and contemplation and studying the Bible and spiritual practice. And so their paranoia had lessened. It lessens your paranoia, which means you're less likely to have this megalomania, and you're willing to have a system of governance that doesn't rely upon the divine right of kings, right? That's why. So are people rooted in spiritual practice now in this country, or are they rooted in their smartphones? If you're not rooted in spiritual practice, you will fall victim to megalomania dictatorship. And I can't get the time of day for most people in the world at all. It's and just going around my entire life here, is I can see people are not rooted in spiritual practice. Now there's still some people whose their parents were, and their grandparents were, and their ancestors were, and there's still that hum, buzz in them, like, but they themselves don't really do it. But once you get like three or four generations removed, you know, that's it, and we're already there. Now, let me see, how do I get this? Lighting shifts, I'll do this, and then this. Okay. We're already there. We're already, with these generations who are growing up, nothing but smartphones and technology. They don't have a clue what being grounded in spiritual practice really means. A life that's the center of your life. Keep in mind that people always used to pray before every meal. They also prayed before bedtime prayers. They went to church every week. They went to Sunday school. A lot of them went through religious educations. And you read the Bible every day, or whatever your holy book is. You read that every day. You read expositions of scripture. You programs you watch. The culture you're involved in is culture based on high morality, high spirit. You know, the highest morality you can get. The movies, etc., are to highlight good examples. So media should be used to highlight good examples. You know, there's no, what's the point in telling it like it is? Or how does that help people? You know, it's just, how does it, wallowing in the vileness of absurdity, how does that help us get free of it? It doesn't. Take this from someone with hindsight. It doesn't help us. You know, oh, the free press, the all these radical things, just always negative, 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 bring out these hideous examples. This subverts, how does that help us? It doesn't, it pulls us down. So the movies, television, movies, radio, all media should highlight the best, great examples. And then people see that and say, oh, this is a role model. I can. And media understands that we're very dependent on role models and external help. And they manipulate that. They cynically manipulate it. And they give us this hideous role models, actually. Say, this is someone you should follow. The people with terrible habits, terrible paranoia. And this drags the whole country down. So, the whole idea of the freedom of the press, all these freedoms, was in a Christian, religious-based country, is they felt, obviously, that's going to be used in a positive way. But also, they allow the freedom of the press to have checks on the power of the executive. But what happens when the press and the executive make a deal and get into bed together? Well, we're living that nightmare right now, actually. What happens when the press itself is subverted by paranoids? They align with a megalomaniac paranoid leader, of course. So the terrible undermining of our culture is you just try to find a good role model. I mean, the movies, all that stuff is obscene, completely immoral. I mean, it's so immoral, there's nothing to even say about it anymore. It went off the rails long ago. That's why I boycotted movies for the last 20 plus years, I would say. Boycott the media, absolutely. My dad made a movie. He was a star, a movie star, and they made a movie back then, and he starred in this movie, which was All American Boy. He was the lead in that, and they showcased him as, this is an ideal. This is the ideal American young man, to be like this. And they tried to show all these virtues that he had. You know, he portrayed all these virtues, a very virtuous person. That was the purpose of it. Now, of course, there is an element of cynicism in that too. It makes you a good warrior. I mean, a good fighter. I mean, you're much more functional. You know, I mean, the greatest generation who fought in World War II, they were very functional people. Very, very independent, capable, resourceful, strong, grounded, you know, because they were brought up right. High morals, you never lie, you never cheat, you never steal. Which is interesting. Trump was was educated in a military academy. That's to just highlight something. And you there's an honor code. You never break that honor code. You always treat all cadets honorably. You never lie to them, ever. You never cheat them in any way. You never steal from them. You never lie, you never cheat, you never steal. And this is an ironclad honor code. You never break that code. And his classmates said, he was outstanding, outstanding that way. And this stays with you. You know, these are principles you need very powerful principles. You have to be someone of great principle in this world and live by those principles. And it's very difficult for us now, right? Back then, also, you didn't take drugs. This is part of the principle, because that subverts the other ones, all of them. It gradually sabotages them. It's a slippery slope. And young people don't have the perspective. They need role models and parents who stand up for that, for principles. And we're taught that standing up for principles, they call it square. You're being square. Whatever that means. You're in a box. Like if your principles, as if your principles, religious, moral principles, put you in some kind of box. So you can't experience what? Licentiousness? Drugs? I mean, you can't experience paranoia, slide into terrible paranoia and all these. Well, yeah, I mean, that's the idea, is that we want to gravitate away from all suffering. Yeah, we want to be in the box of freedom. Absolutely. We want to be in that box, the box of absolute freedom. 1 minute. Rain's coming. Yeah, it's gonna. Well, that's not really rain. It's going to just some sprinkles. So we're covering all this here, rooted in principles, spiritual practice. We've had generations, three generations now, not rooted in principles or spiritual practice in general. It's become diluted to the point of absurdity now. And so people are thinking, oh yeah, I've got strong character, I've got strong principles, no, they don't. No, they don't. Just look at the savageness of this. It's been reported to me, the savagery of this politics right now in the world is just, people, you know, are just losing their minds. You know, they don't understand anymore of democracy. And I was talking with somebody my age, and actually to a couple people my age, and we're like independent, we're not aligned. They say, I vote for whoever the best candidate is. It doesn't matter what party, it doesn't make any difference to me at all. I'm that way too. I don't care. What does that have to do with anything? But the party politics now, the paranoia of party politics is just a sickness, a terrible sickness. And so, even though people think that they're strong inside, they're not. They don't really know what real strength is. You get the older people of my grandparents' generation, my parents' generation, you talk about being grounded in principles, they wouldn't bend. They would not bend. So these are strong moral, spiritual, religious principles, and I'm not going to trespass upon those at all. Under any circumstances, that kind of thing. Now, this was not a political stance. And they'd pick a candidate, say, you know what, this is a candidate has moral principles. They're a principled person. I can see that they will stand on those principles properly, and I'll vote for them. That's how it was. That's how it used to be. until all the special interest groups formed these parties that became so strong. I mean, of course there was bickering back in the past, but a lot of people would cross over. You'd have crossover voting, a lot of crossover voting. And that still happens, but we were more easily fooled now about principles. You get a megalomaniac in elect a megalomaniac, who's which we've already done, who just we hope they have principles. We don't. We're too busy to even look. It took me 10 minutes, but I put my focus. I said, okay, what are the principles? Let me look at his mind. I could see he doesn't have any. His own power is his guiding principle. That's that's not the kind of principles that democracy was looking for. So we're ready to be unhinged. Culture around the world really is ready to be unhinged, but especially, you could say, the United States and Europe's already going toward unhingement. It's like a wildfire, right? A huge wildfire. It spreads. People still look to the United States for principle. And when the United States comes unhinged, what's going to happen to the rest of the world? Really? It's a contagion. You got to have to understand that psychology can become emotionalism is very contagious, so it can become a severe contagion. So how do we avoid that? Grounding in spiritual practice, spiritual principles. We're grounded in that, and we don't bend in from that in any way for anything, for anyone. Christianity is full of martyrs. Why they refuse to bend their principles, for despots who put them to death, tyrants, executive tyrants, divine right of king tyrants, dictators. They put so many Christians to death because the Christians wouldn't bend their principles to suit their megalomania, which is born of paranoia, which is born of absurdity, which is born of denying God. So many Christians, hundreds of millions, really, if you look throughout all of history, been martyred, killed rather than renounce their faith in Jesus, which is ultimately their faith in truth, and ultimately their faith in God, and not their faith in this world. So you could appreciate that Christians have a very raw memory throughout history of suffering a tremendous martyrdom and exterminations and atrocities in their direction, because paranoia sees them as a threat, because they don't share the paranoia, and they refuse to worship the leaders, the totalitarian leaders. Christians refuse to worship leadership like that. They don't worship. They worship Jesus Christ. They don't the Holy Spirit and God. They don't worship. Political, they don't worship leaders of this world, worldly powers, they don't. And this, the megalomaniacs driven by paranoia feel extremely threatened by this. And so there's immense hostility towards Christians and towards religious people in general, refuse to worship secular power. And so the secular humanists, they want to get rid of that. They want their secular humanist utopia where worldly power is worshiped. And they feel that this is going to free them from their paranoia, but they have no spiritual understanding of what's causing the paranoia at all. Therefore, the remedy that they're applying is ridiculous. It's really very ridiculous. How are we going here? 134, okay. So our view, our stance here is to strengthen our spiritual practice, strengthen our spiritual principles, strengthen our clarity. Keep the boycotts in place. Don't get pulled down into that stuff. What did I do this morning? I got up in the morning. I went in and I had a kale smoothie. Very powerful, strong kale smoothie. good way to start the day. It's like drinking straight chlorophyll or something. Straight iron and chlorophyll, I don't know. And I said, okay, you know, what a great way to start the day. And then it's stretching, really strengthen your core. Okay, here's a good, if you want just pragmatic, easy stuff, okay, there's nothing wrong with that too. Do it all if you can, do it all. Actually, I contemplated for hours this morning. I woke up early, didn't sleep much. I had a great spiritual practice. I can't remember what it was. That's okay, because I'm in the wow of that now. This was super profound. Super profound. Then I got up, then I'm stretching, working on my core. I'm working on my core now. The abs, you know, that whole core area, which I hadn't done before. Because you think, oh, it's going to be painful. But now it's not so bad, actually. Strengthen your core. I had this pointed out to me one time without revealing anyone's names or people or whatever, but somebody, when I was in a very, very severe situation, there's a real power struggle taking place. Someone who's heavily aligned with the Mother Goddess, a thuggish person, a woman. She like sucker punched me in the solar plexus, but she pulled her punch. She pulled her punch because it was in public. But she just let me know, we're gonna absolutely punch your gut, believe me. I was like, wow. And I realized just how vicious they are. Just how strong paranoia is governing them. And from that point, I said, don't have a soft gut. You know, don't be punched in the gut. What that means is psychologically, it's like being punched in the gut. And I was punched in the gut in a soccer game in seventh grade so badly, almost killed me. I couldn't breathe. I had someone kneed me in the gut during a soccer game. The solar plexus. I had to be dragged off the field, and it was horrible. That probably let me know the troubles that are to come in this world. That was back in 1967, maybe 68, 67, and you know the turmoil that was to come in the 70s. Going to be severely punched in the gut. So strengthen your core. I know nobody likes to do that, right? When you have a strong core, it helps you psychologically. If you don't react with emotionalism, if you got a soft gut, you tend to be vulnerable to that. So I'm not talking about six-pack abs or anything. I'm just talking about make sure your core is strong. And unfortunately, golf, they tell us that you have to have a really strong core. So you say, keep, how do you exercise that core? I got to do more. I'm starting to do that now. I started like yesterday, the day before, a couple days ago, and it was super sore. I said, oh my gosh. But now I can do a lot of the and it's not sore. It aches a little bit, but it's not that painful soreness. Usually the painful soreness went away in a couple days. So a punch to the gut is coming. A barrage of rocks is coming. The Holy Spirit has emphasized this to the extent that I've never experienced before in my life. How insistent it is that this terrible upcoming trouble with a barrage of rocks. Barak. And so every day I say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to do? I mean, come on, let's do better. And you get up and drink a kale smoothie, you know, you're pretty serious, right? I mean, everybody I talk to, I tell them, they go, ooh, I couldn't do that. And frankly, for the last 6 months, I couldn't do it either. But you get a good picture of how sure I am that trouble is coming, is I'm now chugging kale smoothies. I say, this is great. Actually, what I use cranberry juice, a cran cherry juice, what I'm using now. It tastes great. It tastes great. It's not a problem at all. It's not a problem. You can put some yogurt in with that. You can put some chocolate powder, whatever. It's not bad at all. It's very surprising. I put a lot of kale in. I mean, half a package. You know, this is strong drink. and boycotting sports, which is, I mean, if I told people that I'm boycotting sports, they wouldn't believe me. They say, that's impossible. Are you crazy? You're the last person in the world that they would think, they say, the last person in the world I would think would boycott sports. I always knew what was going on. I was always current with sports. Whatever it is, I know what's going on. I was current with it. That was my news. I stayed away from normal news by paying attention to sports. So it helped free me from the normal news thing. I can still feel like I'm staying current. It's just like, yeah, I know what happened yesterday in sports and what's going to take place today. So it was a way of avoiding. And that. But now I realize it's so invaded by the yoga girls and the New World Order culture. Sports now is being used to suck us into it. And so I said, wow, okay, that's it. It's like a drug now. It's bad. It's being used in a very negative fashion. Sucking us into superficiality very badly. Using all these yoga girl operatives. It's amazing how they just swarmed in and have taken it over in so many ways from the media standpoint. Just astonishing. It's just like a coup. And I saw that. I said, wow. And finally, the Holy Spirit gave me the heads up. I said, it's time. Boycott it. And I said, okay, you got it for that day. It's it. Boycotted it. So that means, you know, somebody is serious enough to do this. To get up in the morning and have one in the morning, one in the evening now, twice a day, kale smoothies. Along with, you know, I can put spinach and mustard greens and collards and all this, you know, heavy green stuff that's like, ah. But it's not bad at all. And you realize, you know, let's get strong. Let's have a buffer to the stress that's coming, to the emotionalism. We don't want to get caught up in that emotionalism. So we want to have really good habits and just stick with them, come thick or thin. We're not going into all the bogus stuff that's happened before under a lot of stress. Society goes into sex, drugs, rock and roll, politics, activism, fake yoga girl spirituality, all this kind of stuff. You stay away from that. We got sucked into, you know, fake tantra in the 70s and 80s, 90s, all this yoga girl fake tantra. You know, they say, oh yeah, I'm really spiritual. I'm into sex tantra, fake tantra, all this kind of fake tantra crap. You know, excuse the terminology. But it was just vile, you know, vile distortion of Hinduism and Buddhism and just a ridiculously vile yoga girl distortion of fake spirituality, which really just undermined true spirituality. Which made us more vulnerable to the New World Order. This is what happened. So many, many, many got pulled down. So many nasty drugs. Cocaine was one of the big culprits, to say the least. And people were just crazy. I mean, you didn't realize that the culture was being driven by a lot of these people who were on cocaine. They just had all this enthusiasm and energy and they seemed to be just like having a great time. And the, you know, the cult, there's a massive effect on that in the culture. The sex tantra is just a very tiny offshoot of very much not emphasized at all in Buddhism or Hinduism. Actually, it comes from the Sahaja movement from Sara. A Mahasiddha of Bengal back in the 10th century or something like that. It was a certain movement among householders and or married people, etc., which was Saraha was totally into wild binging of indulging in all the body, all the cravings of the body, and it was based on that this is a, can be a great positive thing. And this became very popular throughout India, actually, among householders. But it became secret because there was a lot of very bad rituals taking place, sex rituals and drug rituals. They believed in indulging in all that, and then using that to somehow, you know, transcend it or whatever. But that's a very dubious practice, to say the least. And this developed in all sorts of ways, and it became secret because it was really not so good at all. And this is the kind of stuff that these yoga girls and ferreted out, and it permeated Western culture. Like, oh, there's a secret tantric teaching. Well, no, it was secret because it was looked down upon by genuine tantric teachings as being you know, highly dubious and dangerous, actually. So Sahaja Samadhi came out of this. That supposedly he reached Sahaja, which is beyond all pleasures of this and all pleasures of that. I mean, you can put a spiritual framework on, you know, on it, that kind of thing. You can wrap it up in a spiritual package that way. But in no way does that represent, you know, Vajrayana Buddhism or Mahayana Buddhism or Theravada Buddhism or Hinduism. In no way is that representative of what they're teaching at all. But because we thought it was secret, it means it must be most powerful. They don't want us. They don't know. It's because the people who did it, it was so other than what you're supposed to be doing, that they kept it secret so they wouldn't get in trouble. That's why. And so you have these people who claim they're Sahaja Samadhi Mahasiddhi, you know, adepts and stuff, who are just totally into this crazy wisdom of, you know, indulging every possible sense and just all this, you know, tantras of indulgence, all this kind of stuff. This is so much a side trip. Okay, it's such a ridiculous side trip. It's not, it has no respectability attached to it at all. Okay, and you know it, and it's fueled by drugs. You know, cocaine. A lot of drugs actually are involved with it too, which skews your whole perspective on the entire thing. And they say, well, yeah, it's crazy wisdom, you know, and you just and so it's a super potent path, really fast path. No, it's an exploitive path. Is one that ends up exploiting people by a megalomaniac who's driven by paranoia, who has not yet cut through the knot of absurdity, and it still has this feeling that, you know, this is a way to help control people. It's not genuine spiritual practice at all. But it was very influential. But it just showed that should not have a role in contemporary spiritual practice. We have way better understandings than that now, way better. Remember, this spread among householders who were not initiated at all into higher understandings in the spiritual path. They're not dedicated. They're dedicated to their job, their family, their, you know, their spouse, their children, and worldly activity, enjoying the, you know, the flesh. This was a religion for them. That was a way for them. And so, I mean, if your intentions are right, you're going to make it no matter what. But it should ring a red flag to you that how could you stack that up with the religions that were based on dedicated monastic practitioners who dedicated their whole life, who had initiated by spiritual masters, whole lineages, who had instruction and help from the spiritual masters and teachers who had all these safeguards and were brought along in the right way. How can you, you know, compare those? It's ridiculous to compare it. We fell victim to that in the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, where there's way too much immorality and drug use and stress among the society. And people said, hey, you know, I can have my licentious life and still have this super secret profound practice. I'm going to be really have the best of both worlds. None of our teachers have ever advised that. Not at all. They're all sticklers for right morality, right principles. Stay away from that. Longchenpa makes a point of that. He says, yeah, there's some of that in Tibetan. You know, there's certain offshoots. And certain people have tried to act that way. He says, stay away from them. Stay away from them. They bring dishonor upon what we're doing here. They set the wrong example. Okay. He says, you keep yourself on the straight and narrow. And of course, Jesus, absolutely that way. And Ramaharshi, absolutely that way. And Ananda Maima, absolutely that way. So we don't want to make those mistakes that we've made before. So let's learn from our mistakes and don't repeat them. I mean, a fool learns from their own mistakes. A wise person learns from the mistakes of others. And how do you get wise? You learn from mistakes of others, and so you go really fast. You don't repeat their mistakes, and all the delay that that causes. It's ridiculous not to learn from the mistakes of others. I'm trying to express it clearly here to everyone. I don't know what else I can do. But the yoga girls are formidable. They're very formidable. They throw all this accoutrement at you, you know. The beads, the flowers in their hair, the beads, the outfits, the attitudes, the dancing, you know, the freedom, the sensuality of it all. And sure, they can pose the nice yoga poses, sleek, you know, and like, oh, I'm so sleek and clean and stuff. But we're being all inclusive. We're being more tolerant of these practices. These are high practices, you know. We could, you know, no, they're not. No, they're not. They're not high practices in any regard whatsoever. You want a high practice, full stop on the wow is a high practice. You could put it in the echelon of the highest practices, up in that echelon. I'm not running anywhere. I'm not running forward. I'm not running backward. I'm not running off to the side in some wandering direction. I'm not thinking about running. I'm not planning to run. I'm not deciding to run. Okay. I'm just full stop in the wow. This takes your dedication. This is what helps us see all fixation as one folly, and not to try and draw distinctions among what is meaningless. All these attempts to fixate something other than the one fixation of freedom is meaningless, completely meaningless. And this is what we point out here, is to not draw any distinctions or judgment between any of those fixations. Just drop them all at once. We have to be able to do this. So safety is in having be grounded in a profound practice, and full stop in the wow is a profound practice. So I advise all those who want to be grounded in this practice, and insist that I have to keep practicing this. And so if anything shocks you or wow, you say, okay, wow, okay, I gotta do full stop in the wow. This is my practice. This prevents us from being running off in some direction, does it not? Of course it does. Wow. And then you center in your practice. So all the shocking stuff that's coming, we can just say, wow, okay, this just helps me practice. Now I'm going to see full stop in the wow and help me see that all delusional, illusory, make-believe, absurdist fixations are equally untrue. And that I still abide in the one fixation of pure freedom of God, the pure freedom of right action, perfect action, perfect peace, perfect freedom, perfect inherent spaciousness of all. Perfect. I am still abiding in that absolutely perfectly. So be grounded in a great, great high echelon practice. Okay. Don't go in for those super dubious practices that the yoga girls can drag you down into. They're very sneaky about that. Of course they use sex, drugs, and rock and roll to drag you down into it. And glamour. Very seductive. And their purpose is to ultimately lead you towards this flesh-based utopia, which we know is a disaster because it's run by paranoia, megalomaniacal paranoiacs who insist on total control of your life. So there you have it. So I highly advocate being grounded in a super high spiritual practice, and I'm convinced that this full stop in the wow is that. There's no question that when I came up on Talopa's basically almost identical practice, he said, this is the six keys of my advice. These are six keys, and he's a very high teacher. It's like, wow. It's like they're saying basically the exact same thing. This is like the super high practice. But not so difficult that someone can't do it. And of course, it's also the high practice of Atta Yoga is to truly also take, I'm already there, you know, this, I'm already there. So full stop in the wow is also emanating like, I'm already there. This, my practice has been totally successful. Wow. So you re-emphasize, I can, I will, I've already done it. That's what I did this morning. I said, my practice is, I'm already successfully practiced. Wow. Instead of trying to recall what I practiced, which I forgot, I said, no, I've already succeeded at this practice. I did a fabulous practice I've already succeeded at. And then this brings up the wow. Because ultimately, it's just a simple shift that all we have to do, just to see the inherent spaciousness of everything. That we can never move out, nothing can move out of that. And that brings the stillness there, the freedom, the stillness, the right action. It's all there, all is one. And so we have to keep emphasizing how easy it is. But whenever we emphasize that, a wow reaction will come up. Like we want to run, oh my God, a burst of like, oh my gosh, a burst of reaction comes up, a burst of reaction. And we need to allow that reaction to calm down without us trying to do anything about it. Because trying to do anything about what is already inherently true is what deludes us. There's nothing we have to do to establish our one fixation in God. It's already true. We just need to stop trying to fixate ourselves in God. Or to fixate ourselves in anything. We were created as fixated in truth and freedom. So a burst of reaction arises, full stop, and that wow. We just call it wow. We don't try to label it in any other way. So this is a safeguard against what is to come. It's the only safeguard there is to be grounded in a very high spiritual practice that you can turn to continuously, easily, continuously. Just say, wow. Whatever your reaction is, oh my gosh, wow. And then remind you, oh, yeah, I have this practice called full stop and the wow. And then immediately you get into this, how easy it is to remember this practice, which is really important, because when you get buffeted by all this stuff that takes place in turmoil, you're like, I don't know how to practice, I don't know how to practice, I don't practice. Oh wow, look at this, this is happening, oh wow, oh wow. But we have this term, wow, oh wow, oh wow, oh, that's my practice. So it's a way of reminding ourselves that I do have a practice, and then right away, you start going back into the practice and you feel yourself being centered. Your whole disposition smooths out from emotionalism to one of clarity and adamant beingness, you know, very adamant. Like, I know the truth. I don't need to react to all this stuff. So, super helpful. And this is just full on go time now. So keep with it. Try to adopt this. This is what I'm offering, because for me, I need to know how to get into practice immediately. Wow, there I am, right in practice. Oh, look at all the waves. Wow. Oh yeah, full stop in the wow. Don't forget my practice. Look at all this happening. Okay, wow. And so it keeps you grounded during the day continuously. You're able to do that. You don't start straying off real badly this way. And this is what's crucial during times of great turmoil, which I have certainly been through. I can report to you that it's terrible. You become ungrounded and you become prey then. The predators start culling you off, you know. It's like, you know, predators follow a herd or something. They follow along and see who's limping, who's starting to struggle. Then they target you that way. Literally, this is what happens. There's so much predatorial paranoia turns into predatorial activity. And like I say, the yoga girls will go after you. And their cohorts, yoga girls and all their cohorts, they'll start targeting you. And the targeting of paranoia is very determined and very clever. You know, and they have their systems of how to lead you astray and pull you down so they can control you. Their way of avoiding stress is control others in a bad way, okay, in a dependency way. Okay, what we're doing here is empowering you to go to a spiritual practice where you stay centered in truth. And so you're your own, nobody can control you in a negative way, okay? This is very important. No one can control you in a negative way. Someone can inspire you in a positive way, that's fine. But the inspiration you should seek is those who are inspiring you to center yourself in a powerful, right, highest echelon spiritual practice that you can return to again and again, and it doesn't require some control system or special relationship. The yoga girls will tell you, well, you can't make it without a special relationship. This is this whole soul, you need a soul partner thing. And that was what the 70s and Richard Bach, Jonathan Lewis and Siegel and all this stuff is you have to have a dyad, a soul partner. There's a yoga girl trick, it's a lie. later he finally renounced that. As they all do, eventually they say, wow, that wasn't it. That was a trap. As Ram Maharshi said, the whole world is my guru. Look at it that way. Seriously. You have a guru, it's everything in the world is my guru. In terms of a reminding guru, okay, here, you know, what's here? We have our four great spiritual teachers, the four great pillars here. But as far as you, in your activities, you're going around the world, he said, you don't mind, everything in the world was my guru. Because everything reminded me, you know, I need to practice the truth. So do not, there's so much false teaching about you have to have a partner. Have to have this dyadic thing, partner. You can't ascend, you can't rapture without, this is all junk. It's all absolute junk. Course in Miracles says how it was designed for people who are in relationship. And it says you can use that relationship, give it a different purpose, and it can be very helpful for you. Now this is true. This is true. But if it says you have to be in a special relationship or have a partner, that, for me, that's going too far. It's not true at all. Because literally, really, the whole world is our partner. Everything in the world is my guru. It's all my guru. So there's no specialness anywhere there. But Jesus recognized that we're caught in the special relationships, thinking that's the answer. And he says it's never the answer. But what you can do, he says, I don't advise you. The problem was that people are just divorcing, having all these multiple partners. This is a disaster. He said, use the special relationship you're in and give it a different purpose. And this will actually help you go very fast on the path. It's a path for like householders. You know, who people are in special relationship, because most of us in the modern secular world are, okay? And then it prevents you from getting into trapped by the yoga girls. I've got to hop from here to here to here, and you gradually go down, 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 down. So in other words, whatever trouble you're having in whatever relationship you're having, you give it a different purpose. You look at it in a different way. That someone's helping me. They're showing me something. It's a type of practice, a tantric practice, so to speak. Tantric just means a particular spiritual practice. Okay, a type of method of spiritual practice. A skillful means, and I always say, it's skillful means in spiritual practice. Skillful means is you think everything is just God's grace and it's helping you. Everything is God's grace and it's helping you. But Jesus absolutely condemned the special relationship, the romantic, love-based special relationship, you know, that kind of thing. He absolutely condemned it. He said it's the worst thing there is. But he doesn't advise you to, he knew that most people are not going to be monastic. This is not a monastic age, okay, which it isn't at all. So, you know, he has to help people where they're at. So he emphasized that. But if you're single, make the whole world is your guru, which I think is just as good, if not better. The whole world is your guru. Now, this is actually also a path of bhakti yoga or service yoga, too. Sava yoga, bhakti yoga. It's a path. The whole world is my guru. Everyone is my guru. The whole world is my guru. There's no special guru. Everyone in the world is my guru. Everything. Everything. Every action. All of it. The whole world is my guru. Is my teacher. That's also a great path. Everything you see is a reminder to center yourself and practice liberation from definition. As we say, put everything in the fire, and what is left is what you really are. What is left is fixation as freedom. So put all fixation in. Christianity says, give it all to Jesus, all everything, and he'll give back to you what is true. Jesus advises us too, which is the one fixation, which is we are God being God, we're pure freedom. All other fixations are not true. But full stop in the wow, this is what I've been led to. This is a saving grace of a practice. And always easily center yourself. Oh yeah, I'm experiencing the wow of what? Of success. The wow of success. You have to see the wow of success. Even when you turn away from delusion, the wow's going to hit you. You say, oh my gosh, I just turned away from it. This is fantastic. This is wonderful. And then you get a big hit of reactivity from that. And you have to cool down from that. So the drive towards a secular humanist utopia is super virulent right now. It's the worst virulence in the history of this planet. It's the worst plague in history right now. And it's becoming very virulent now. It's spring, now March 2016. It is now coming into full-blown virulency. Okay. And it's driven by paranoia, plain and simple. Severe psychotic paranoia, actually. This is what absurdity comes with, absurdity, inseparable from absurdity, which is the attempt to define what we are, which is coming from our arrogance of trying to be greater than God. This is the etiology, the theological etiology of the entire situation. So full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. Live it, live it, live it. There's no, you know, you're in charge of that, your spiritual practice, right? And it's simple, and you realize it's safe. You just say, okay, I'm just going to full stop in this wow. Whatever the wow is, I can full stop in this. So I'm in charge. It cannot get the best of me, whatever it is. If Jesus appears in front of me right now, I have this practice. If it's too much, I can full stop in the wow and remain centered. You know, right? So even something really great occurs, or something terrible, it's the same, it's both. You have a wow reaction to full stop in the wow. So it's a very protective practice, very, very much so. So stick with it, stick with it. I'm gonna keep pushing the best I can and put it out there for you. Okay, very great. Happy Palm Sunday to those who are Christians. This is the day that Jesus entered Jerusalem. Very symbolic day. They put palm branches in front of him as he rode the donkey. And Hosanna, 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 King of the Jews is coming. The Messiah is coming, the King of the Jews, and they welcomed him into Jerusalem, the spiritual center of Judaism. They didn't realize, of course, that he was coming to be crucified there. So Palm Sunday is, you know, it's a big day, big day, big day. And certainly being one of the four great pillars of this full stop in the wow practice, we absolutely celebrate this day and highlight Jesus Christ, who is put all fixations all at once in front of God. Says, here, God, you don't need to judge anyone individually. Just judge us all collectively, and I'll take all the weight of that judgment upon me. That's what he said. I'll take all the weight of your judgment upon me, and I'm taking all fixations from everybody as my own fixations. So judge it all. And I'll take the judgment on me. That's what Jesus did. And of course, God laughed and said, you can't fool me, Jesus. You're my perfect son, the perfect son. You're perfect freedom. I created perfect freedom. And there is no fixation but that. Okay? And that means both you and everybody else is absolutely saved from any judgment from me whatsoever. I have no judgment upon you. You're perfect as I created you, and that's it. That's my final judgment. So that's how great a teacher, that's how great a pillar of truth Jesus is. That's how great a pillar he is. He wasn't afraid to take all fixations as his own and put himself in front of God's judgment seat and say, okay, God, judge me. So that freed us, everyone, up from all delay, essentially, right? It's already been done. The judgment has already been rendered upon us, and that is, the final judgment is no judgment at all. We're still exactly as God created us to be. I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. So today is a day, and we go into Easter week, is a day to celebrate this fabulous, great help that we have in Jesus Christ. Someone who did that and showed us this is the truth. Massively helpful, massively helpful. Without any way diminishing the helpfulness of these other teachers, skillful means, very skilled and skillful means in realization on their own right as well. Because they know the exact same truth. Jesus did it in a very dramatic way. Okay, very dramatic way, so it would resonate with everyone, really resonate powerfully. He even went through the crucifixion, allowed the judgment of death upon God's Son and torture upon God's Son to rest upon him also. So in other words, he brought himself in front of God as this tortured, crucified, dead corpse, along with all the other fixations that we have, and said, okay, God, judge me. Am I really this dead, crucified, tortured corpse in front of you with all these other sins, or am I the Holy Son of God that you created? And God said, you're the Holy Son of God, as I created you. That means, so we all are also the same. The judgment upon Jesus is the same judgment upon all of us, which is, we're perfect as God created us to be. We're absolutely fixated in our perfection, God being God. So, happy Palm Sunday, everybody. I don't know how many clearly see this. They like the ritual and the palm leaves and everything, but you know, it's great that we can express this here when we're still free to do so, isn't it? Okay. Happy Palm Sunday, everybody. Full stop in the wow.